Hey guys, thank you so much for checking out my new cover. If you like this video, please give it a thumbs up. And don't forget to subscribe and turn on that bell. The bell. Thank you.
Good morning. Welcome to Fairview. We're so glad you're here this morning. God is a great God. Amen. Good all the time. He answers our prayers. He meets our needs. He's always there for us. And what a God we have who can save us and who can change our lives and give us peace and joy and satisfaction. And we're here to worship Him. And I want us to worship Him. I was reading something this week and said, if you can't worship Him here, you won't be worshiping Him there. So we need to learn how to worship here, amen, and sing unto. So today when the choir sings or the worship team sings and whatever, the congregation, participate, sing. I know that we here don't know how to clap very well. I am being threatened to have by a certain lady that I won't mention her name or initials or Amy, that she's going to have a clapping song to teach you how to clap. I'll try to be gone that Sunday. And but if you see the song she's trying to bribe me with, it's amazing. Would you? Let's pray. What a joy to be in the house of the Lord, to know that we come to worship you and to give you praise and honor and glory to your name. Lord, there's no way that we can give you the worship you deserve, but accept our worship today. Bless each and every one here today. Challenge our hearts through song and sermon. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Aren't you glad we can come to church and be silly and laugh? Preacher said he's going home. He's taking his toys and he's going home. All right, stand with us this morning as we sing, What a Friend We Have in Jesus.
What a privilege to care.
My feet are on the rock. I can feel the waters rise. I can hear the howling lies that haunt me. Fear won't hold me now. My feet are on the rock.
When I feel my heart fall, fountain breaks, I will cling to your unchanging grace. Let the waters come and the earth give way. I'll be dancing in the rain. My feet are on the rock.
I can see the morning light. I can feel the joy on the horizon. Here my faith is found. I stand on solid ground.
When I feel my hope about to break, I will cling to your unchanging grace. Let the waters come and the earth give way. I'll be dancing in the rain.
Christ, the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. So stomp your feet and clap your hands, our feet are on the rock.
On Christ, the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. So stomp your feet and clap your hands, our feet are on the rock.
On Christ, the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. So stomp your feet and clap your hands, our feet are on the rock.
I will cling to your unchanging grace. Let the waters come and the earth give way. I'll be dancing in the rain. When I feel my hope about to break, I will cling to your unchanging grace. Let the waters come and the earth give way. I'll be dancing in the rain.
At the drop of a hat, God, my turn is back and move on. A lot of us feel like we blew it, thinking that we're just too far gone. But I want you to know there's still a hope for you now. No matter what. Get honest. There's never been a better time to get clean. So come as you are, run to the cross and be free. Oh, be free.
No matter what you've done, you can't erase His love. Nothing can change it. You're not separated. Always.
Thank you, praise team. That was a powerful song. Thank you, Sonia. Wow. What a truth it is. Amen. Let's continue. Remember the Vera Israel family, Vivian's sister, so many in the church are involved with it, Lynn, sister. But I do want to thank all those who served and all those who brought food. It was a large family, and y'all did excellent, and I'm proud of you, and I thank you for it, but you always do that, and I know it takes extra effort on your part, but I would just ask you, if you're asked to fix something, please help us, and that is always helpful, because one day that might be your family, and we do want to continue that ministry. It is a good ministry, a helpful ministry, and has ministered to so many people. God is a good God, as I said. I want to speak to you today on something that has troubled me all of my life as a pastor. And that is, just give me a popular religion. Give me a popular religion. Now, let me just, by way of introduction, let's just look at Acts chapter 26. If you'll go there, we'll read a passage, Acts chapter 26. Next chapter 26, verse 1. Then Agrippa said unto Paul, Thou art permitted to speak for thyself. Then Paul stretched forth the hand and answered for himself. I think myself happy, King Agrippa, because I shall answer for myself this day before thee, touching all things whereof I am accused of the Jews. Especially because I know thee to be expert at all customs and questions which are among the Jews. Wherefore I beseech thee to hear me patiently. My manner of life from my youth, which was at first among mine own nation at Jerusalem, unknown all the Jews, which knew me from the beginning, if they would testify that after the most strictest sect of our religion, I lived a Pharisee. Now I want you to get that. After the most strictest sect of our religion, I lived as a Pharisee. There was two boys that were called to the pastor's office, and he took one of them in and had one sit outside the pastor's office, and so the boy sat down, and the pastor looked at him and said, Son, I have a question for you, and I want you to think hard about it before you give me the answer. And the boy said, Yes, sir. And the pastor said to the boy, Tell me, son, where is God? And the boy gulped, thought for a while, and looked at the pastor, and he was nervous, and he was shaking. And the pastor said, Son, where is God? And the boy hesitated again, and he wanted to give the right answer. He didn't want to give the wrong answer, but he wasn't sure what to say. Then for the third time, the pastor said, Son, where is God? By this time, the boy is very nervous, frustrated, and suddenly he jumps up and runs out of the office and grabs the other boy by the hand and said, Come on, we got to get out of here. They've lost God, and they're accusing us of hiding him. You know, sometimes we ask the question, Where's God? Today, there's many places of worship that have lost God, literally. The Apostle Paul tells us about those places, if you will. They are righteous, but they're not truly spiritual. Without the Spirit, you're just a religion at best. Now, today, I just want to let you know that there's so many places in America that are called houses of worship, but they're not. Understand, before Paul's salvation on the road to Damascus, the Apostle Paul was one of the most religious men in the world. In fact, in Acts 26, verse 5, he replied, After the most strictest sect of our religion, I lived a Pharisee. And if you know anything about Pharisees, you understand that they were not Christians at that time. In fact, they were anti-Christian. They were anti-Christ. They were literally committing people to prison. They were literally causing people to be murdered, to lose their homes, because they would not follow Judaism, a religion. And it wasn't about salvation. It was about joining their religion and doing their works. And so Paul was very strict about that, and he was helping going into homes. He was persecuting people. He was committing them to prison, and he was doing it all under the name of religion. While the world is plagued with religion, Religion is the biggest tool to prevent people from going to heaven than it is getting people into heaven. Did you hear what I said? It's the biggest tool preventing people from getting into heaven rather than getting people to heaven. Man is basically a religious creature. In fact, the matter is, he's going to worship something or somebody. Everyone in this room, if you don't worship God, you're worshiping somebody, and it might be yourself or something. It may be a car, a home, a whatever, popularity, sports, whatever. You're worshiping it, but you're going to worship something. You're going to have something that's a priority in your life. You're going to have something that's going to take first place, and no matter what else happens in life, no matter what else comes in life, I'm going to do this before I do anything with the true living God. It is a religion, and religion is killing us all the world. The Persians had their Zendavesta. The Hebrews had the Talmud. The Chinese had the Confucius. And they had their own god, Confucius. The Japanese had Shintos, and the Buddha had God's shelf. The Muhammad had Koran. The Muslims had Mecca. The Hindu had Shasta. And it's interesting when you study that, Shasta is an interesting religion, if you will, because it worshiped cows and rivers and creation. And those who were less religious had Diet Shasta. But anyway, you look at, that was a joke, you can smile if you want to. Anyway, if you look at all the cults of the world, you have the Mormons, they're everywhere. You have the Jehovah's Witness, they're beating on our doors with a mission. They have a mission field of their whole world, and they're out working. You have the Christian Science and all others who mingle with the leaven through bread in our society. And what is happening? People are joining those, quote, churches, joining those, quote, religions. And it is a religion. It has nothing to do with God. Not the true and living God. Not with the Word of God. It is a religion. And they're falling for it by the millions. People are following that. In fact, you could talk about religions being broken down in hundreds of different denominations. They're the Jews, they're the Catholics, the Greek Orthodox, the Lutherans, the Episcopalians, the Presbyterian, the Church of God, the Church of Christ, the Church of God in Christ, the Nazarenes, the Unity, the Apostolic, the Reform, the Angelical, the Gay Church, the Church of Satan, and there's so very many other denominations. There's dozens of different Baptists. There is what is called the American Baptist, the Free Will Baptist, the German Baptist, the Swedish Baptist, the Southern Baptist, the Conservative Baptist, the General Baptist, the General Association of Regular Baptists, the Old Baptist, the Hard Shell Baptist, the Soft Shell or Half Shell Baptist, the Primitive Baptist, the Missionary Baptist, Independent Baptist, and even have what it called now is the Lily Baptist. Now, I want to ask you a question. Why is people confused about God? Why in the world are so many people confused? I was talking to Brian Sonia this morning before service. And this thing called COVID has done more damage to the church than anything I know in years. It's caused the church to be divisive, caused the church to be fearful. Because those who wear masks are upset with those who don't wear masks, and those who don't wear masks are upset with those who do wear masks. And those who don't get the shot blame those who do get the shot, and those who do get the shot blame those who don't get the shot. Satan is having a heyday because we're more concerned about what people are doing about this, quote, plague or whatever you want to call it. But I'm going to tell you something. We got to get our eyes back on God. We got to get our eyes back on each other, to love each other no matter what. You have a right to your opinion. I have a right to my opinion. If you want to be wrong, that's all right. But at the same time, we need to love each other. Because there are people out there that are dying. There are people out there that are crying. And they need God. And a time like now, where so many things are going wrong in our country, where our country is more divided now than ever before, we need something better than a religion. We need something called Christianity. We need something that calls that we are Christ's children, that we are born again. We have the Holy Spirit living in our life. We're different. We've been saved. We've been changed. We've been born again. We've been regenerated. We have heaven as our home. We have a hope that's steadfast and sure, and no one can take that from us. And we ought to thank God for that. It's amazing to me that as you look at religion, None of the religions above have the market on truth. And why do you say that? And why do we care about religion at all? Well, religion is mentioned only three times in the Bible. It's mentioned in Acts 26, verse 5, the passage we read today. It's mentioned in Galatians chapter 1, verse 13 and 14 twice. And it's mentioned in James chapter 1, verse 26 and 27. Three particular places that religion, or the word religion, is mentioned. Paul was not fond of religion. After he had the Roman Road, after he had the Damascus Road experience, God saved him. And that point on, it was not about religion. It was about relationship. Religion is always doing things. Christianity is being. Religion is always about works, works, works. Religion, or Christianity, is about worship and serving the Lord Jesus Christ. In fact, Galatians chapter 1, verse 13 and 14 said, "For ye have heard of my conversion in time past in the Jewish religion, and profited in the Jewish religion above many my equal in mine own nation, being more excellently zealous of the traditions of my father." Paul is saying, you have to understand, at one time, I was all about religion. I was all about traditions. I was all about works. I was all about all of these requirements that God used to require in the Old Testament when there was not Jesus Christ. He had not come on the cross of Calvary. And so what they were doing, their religion was always about sacrificing and doing this and doing this and doing this and doing this. Religion is not a heart thing. It's a head thing. In fact, Ezekiel said, "For with their mouths they show much love, but their hearts goeth after covetousness. And they hear thy word, and they do not do them." In chapter 33, verse 31 and 32, Paul tells us in Titus chapter 1, verse 16, he says, "They profess that they know God, but in their words they deny him. They say one thing, and they're speaking another thing." Paul tells us also in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 5, he says, "They were having a form of godliness, religion, but denying the power thereof." Listen to me. Jesus told us in Matthew chapter 6, verse 5, they love to pray standing in the synagogues and in the corners of the street and that they may be seen. And religion is always about being seen. It's always about doing things for popularity, doing things because you want to do it, and that's the thing you want. You want something that you can have, and you can say, "I'm religious and I'm on my way to heaven," but you want it in your manner and your way, and you want it how you want it. I would say to you, the world seems to want religion, a religion that will accept them as they are, permanently and without a challenge. Otherwise, the world is saying, "Give me something that I can say I'm religious, I'm right with God, but don't give me something that challenges me or causes me to change." The world wants a religion that goes along with what they already believe. And there are a lot of churches that accept people in membership for their offerings of their church, but they don't have them do anything. They don't want to do anything. Popular religion. A religion is that which would not object to what they are now doing. There's no objection. I was listening to a documentary on preachers in America who have large churches and what they were saying. You can join their church, and you don't have to do anything. You don't even have to be saved. They won't talk about hell. They won't talk about getting right with God. They won't talk about sin. They won't talk about living for God. They always talk about the good life. Always talk about giving to them, giving to their church. They're always talking about happiness and satisfaction. But they never talk about what God says about getting right with him and having our lives changed and getting involved in his church and serving his church, and the commandments of his are not grievous to us. We just not only know the commandments, but we want to do them. We know what God tells us to do, and we do not argue about what God says. But they don't want that. A religion that will let all men be brothers and still believe whatever they want to believe. In fact, the most popular religion in the world today transcends many denominations It circles our globe. It's in the hearts of so many who don't go to church, and many who love, many are lost people, but also many are considered to be saved, and it's likely local. They're right here in the right here, even in our congregation, and various congregations right here in Spartanburg. The world's most popular religion. There's four things I would think about it. Number one, the world's most popular religion will tell you, don't give me a religion that has requirements. Don't give me something that has requirements. Don't hold me back. Don't slow me down. Do not inhibit me. You say a popular religion must be one that has little or no requirements, no qualifications, and no duties. Give me something that all I have to do maybe to go to church once a week or maybe once a month. I don't want to do anything. I don't want to serve anything. I don't want to be anything. Just I want to be free to do whatever I want to do. And if I want to come to church, I'll come to church. If I don't want to come to church, I'm not coming to church. Church is no longer a priority in my life. I'm just going to serve God my way. I'm not going to have any of these requirements that you say that we have to have. I'm going to make my own requirements. I'm going to make my own ways, and I'm going to determine what is right and what is wrong. Religion that will be popular causes folks really to rally around themselves because they understand, they believe that we're just together. We're all brothers and sisters. God created all of us. God loves all of us. So we're all Christians. How many times have you heard someone die who's a wicked person and you listen to their relatives and those folks are in heaven? See, this type of religion, they don't want the requirement of repentance. Remember, Jesus said, except you repent, ye shall all likewise perish. Repentance means a change of mind. It means a turn of direction. Why should I go to repent? Why should I repent, they say? I mean, I'm good, ain't I? I'm good enough as I am. By the way, why should I repent? God created me the way I am. And if God created me the way I am, why should I change? It's His fault, not mine. Why should I have to repent? I mean, I'm a good person. God is good and God is loving and God is always compassionate. And He wouldn't send me to hell, would He? I mean, don't tell me I have to change. I am one of God's special creation. I don't need to repent. I'm doing all right for myself. They also say, please don't require me regeneration. Regeneration is after repentance. It's talking about a changed life. They don't want to include in popular religion. They don't want to hear this. You must be born again. Your life must be changed. You must be a different person. Why do I have to change? Why do I have to be different than I am now? And why do I have to change my lifestyle? Listen to me. I am God's creation again. Why in the world would I have to be, quote, born again? Don't give me any type of requirements that causes me to do anything or change my lifestyle. I want to be a religious person. I want to be able to pray to God, but I don't want to have to do anything else. From the president on down, people are talking about, let's pray to God. And when you listen to them and you watch them and you realize they're not saved, and yet they sit and pray to God, how can they do that? Their prayers are not being answered by God. If you don't know Jesus Christ as a personal Savior, He does not hear your prayers. The only prayer He will hear is the prayer of repentance. I don't want a religion that has that requirement of restricting me, restrictions. Popular religion will not insist on making right and wrong decisions. It doesn't insist on having to straighten out your life. Preacher, you don't realize all the things that in my life, and I don't want to be restricted. I don't want to have to do things stop doing things that I enjoy. But listen, I want to be happy. This makes me happy. This satisfies me. Why in the world would I have to be restricted in what I do and what I say? Don't give me religion that has retribution. I mean, listen to me. They don't want to insist on a retribution. They don't want to insist on eternal hell. Let's do away with hell. How often have you heard hell mentioned in churches across America or on television? Not very much. There's a hot lot more said about hell in the Word of God than you realize. And there are a lot more people going to hell than there are heaven. In fact, hell is going to have to be enlarged to take all the people that's going to go to hell. People sitting in this auditorium this morning, and I am not judging you, but if you don't know Jesus Christ as a personal Savior, if you're not serving Him, if you're not right with Him, if you're not where you ought to be with God, listen to me carefully. Hell will probably be your home. I'm sick and tired of people saying, well, he got saved when he's 2 years old. He's lived like the devil, he's walked like the devil, he smells like the devil, he talks like the devil, but since he got saved at two, he's a Christian. That is a lie, and it's going to send more people to hell thinking they're going to heaven. Now tell someone when they got saved as a teenager that they're saved at 40, and since a teenager life, they've lived like the devil, they've cursed God, they've drunk. Listen, don't tell me that. You're offering a cheap, easy believism. That is not in Scripture. And religion says what happens. Oh, well, you'd have that relationship with God, but all you, then you just go around and tell everybody you're all right. And because of that experience, you can go to heaven, so do what you want. I believe a lot of people have had an experience with God, but that wasn't salvation. There are a lot of young people who came to the altar because their friend came to the altar. It was the thing to do. And so they, quote, got, quote, saved, unquote. And then they lived like the devil the rest of their life. And I had him talk to me, and then he talked to me. He said, you know what? I've never lived for the Lord all my life. But I had this experience as a teenager. I said this. And they got baptized. Years ago, there was several churches here in Spartanburg. And a lot of the fellows got drafted for the war. So one Sunday morning, the pastor called all the fellows that were going over, being drafted, leaving, to come forward. And he said, this morning what we're going to do, because you're going overseas, and you're going to war, and you're probably going to get killed, what we're going to do is we're going to baptize you this morning so that you will have heaven as your home in case you get killed. And some of those people are still alive today, believing they're right with God because they got baptized that day. Some of those people got killed, and they believe they're in heaven because they got baptized that day. Being baptized and not being saved first is as good as me baptizing a sparrow. It's not going to do you a bit of good. And that's what religion wants. They don't want accountability. So why is it that Fairview, we have to insist on some things, and it's not because it will make us popular. That's not the reason. If our only goal is to grow numerically, we're doing it all wrong. Because if we want to grow numerically, let's stop having restrictions. Let's get away with all that stuff. And let's just grow with numbers. And if you think numbers are what makes the church great, you're far off. It's not numbers that makes the church great. It's the Holy Spirit. It's people who are getting saved. It's people growing in the saving grace of the Lord Jesus Christ. But our goal at Fairview is to grow spiritually, which will often lead to numerical growth. Our goal is to lead people to Jesus Christ who insist on some other things. But let me tell you something. It is our responsibility as a church, my responsibility as a pastor, to speak the truth, period. We're to teach the truth, period. We cannot deviate from the truth. And we, because we don't like something or because we think that there's something more important than what God says, to deviate from that does not make it right. Someone said to me one time before they died, preacher, I've never done anything for Jesus. I've never tithed. I've never went to church very often. Every time there was a ball game or something, I went there. And every time there was this, I went there. And he said, you know, I found out now, I'm laying in the bed, there are many friends of mine who went to the ball game on Sunday that I could have won to the Lord, but I couldn't because I was doing the same things they were doing. And I was telling them that church is not important. It's not a priority in my life. And I'll be honest with you. If sports is your number one God, and God's not your number one thing, you got a problem. You got a spiritual problem. If you have to defend yourself from not doing what's right. Now, don't get me wrong. I'm not saying that you have to be to church every time the doors are open. But if you never come to church and this becomes your priority, I think something's wrong, don't you? Thank you, well, all three of you. Appreciate it. Blesses my heart. Some places, if you only give an offering, they will leave you alone. They will never challenge you. And never mind what you're going through in your life. Never mind what you're doing. Never mind that you're growing away from God. Never mind that your heart's getting cold. Never mind that your heart's getting different. Never mind that you've lost your challenge for God. You've lost your motivation. You've lost that spirit. Said, God, we got to do something. We got to reach people. We got to teach people. We got to do something. Never mind that we have lost in our churches and even Fairview that spirit that says, we've got to do something. The world is dying. Men and women are crying. They need Jesus Christ. And we're sitting here playing tiddlywinks, twiddling our thumbs, trying to think how we can cancel services and not do this and not do that. While the world grows and grows and grows and keeps doing more and more things, something is dead wrong. Our philosophy of ministry here is a biblical one. It says you are more important than what you can do or what you can give. We must be more interested in what we can do for you than what you can do for us. Though what you do and what you give are good indications of who you are and what you are and whose you are. If we focus on you, I do believe that we can receive a lot more in return. This ought to be a ministry is for people more than people are for the ministry. Well, don't give me a religion that has repercussions. Let me take out Revelation 21:8. Let's just rip it out of the Bible and let's just tear it up. Because in Revelation chapter 21, verse 8, it says, but the fearful and the unbelieving and the abominable and the murderers and the whoremongers and the sorcerers and the idolaters and all liars will have their place in the lake of fire, which burneth with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. God lists things of people who will not be in heaven. This is not the only passage. There are other passages that talk about the adulterer, and the fornicator and all those other things will not have their place in heaven. And yet we think in America that it's all right to do all those things. Don't give me religion that says I have to stop living together. Don't give me a religion that says I have to stop cussing. Don't give me a religion that says has to say that I got to stop drinking. Don't give me a religion that says that I have to be right with God. I need to get in my Bible and I need to pray and I need to give and I need to attend church. Don't give me that religion. I don't want that junk. That's where we live in America. I don't want any repercussions. Listen, you mean to tell me that I have to read a book that's 66 chapters written by over 60 authors thousands of years ago, and that has to be my manual? I mean, I'm a person who needs numerous choices. Don't just give me one choice. Give me many choices. Surely there's many ways to heaven. Why would I have to have the book? Why do I need a Bible? And before you get so upset with me, you say, well, yeah, the world's not reading the Bible. But if I ask for people to raise their hand today that's read the Bible, the entire Bible, since you've been saved, how many of you couldn't raise your hands? Don't raise your hand. How many of you read the Bible every day? How many of you are in the Word of God and the Word of God's in you? Here's what's happening. We get so busy in this world that we're too busy even to get in the book. And yet we want the lost people to be saved through the book that we don't even read. Don't give me religion. You mean I got, in order to get to heaven, that I have to have this as my roadmap? I don't want that. I mean, you guys talk about the blessed hope. Listen to me. I don't so sure I like that. I mean, I want religion like the people, like the Pharisees, and who honestly did not look forward to heaven. They did not look forward to heaven. In fact, they thought about worshiping, and they thought about adoring God and sitting there all eternity worshiping and adoring God. It's not for them. It's very boring. And it's very evident in our churches today. We're not worshiping God. We're not adoring God. Here's what happens. Most of us come to church because it's Sunday morning, and we have to. And we can't wait till Sunday school's over. We can't wait till morning worship service is over so we can get out to dinner, or we can go home, or we can do this, or we can do that. And what has happened the whole time we're having services? Our mind's not on the church. Our mind's not on God. Our mind's on ourselves and what we can do. We have forgotten that the blessed hope only children of God can have that blessed hope of Jesus Christ taking us to heaven. Well, give me a religion that's a bloody religion. You know, the lamb died in Eden, and Canaan offering was rejected, and Abel's offering was accepted. Abraham and Isaac offered Isaac to God, and God gave them a substitute. The life of the flesh is in the blood, the Bible says. In fact, it says in 1 Peter chapter 1, you were not redeemed with corruptible things of silver and gold. Otherwise, you can't buy your way. You can't get right because of what you do. You can't buy your way to heaven because of what you give. But with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. The Bible teaches that redemption involves the blood atonement. It's not popular. The blood of Christ on the cross is not popular. And they're trying to take the blood out of the hymnals. And there are many churches that if you would pick up their hymnals, every song that mentions the blood has been taken out of their books. And some churches have taken out any hymnal that has the word hymn in it, H-I-M. Because they say that God is not a he, God might be a she. I saw one person the other day and I thought, are they a he or she, or are they he-she? I wasn't sure. But you have to be careful, you know, nowadays what you say and what you do. Give me a religion that has no restrictions. Just because the Bible says in 2 Corinthians verse 6, verse 17, come out from among them, be ye separate. We don't want to hear that. Popular religion doesn't want any restriction for man's pleasures and customs and hobbies and habits and jobs and sports and families and personal plans. They want a popular religion that allows man to be and do and go in and where he wants to without any restrictions. In other words, most people want a religion that literally they can put a coat on Sunday morning, a Christian coat on Sunday morning, go home Sunday afternoon and put it in the closet and put on their secular coat and live like that the rest of the world, and the rest of the week, and next Sunday put on their religious coat. Let me tell you, religion, righteousness, is not an outward covering. It is an inward cleansing. If it's not on the inside, it's not going to be on the outside. And by the way, it tells us our hearts. Because everything we love and everything we want comes from our hearts. Some say, you know, I'd rather have a Saturday night service. I want a real, real early morning service. Give me a religion of convenience. Don't tell me I want something that I can get away from as quick as I can. I think it's all right to change hours of services. You know, we do it here because of work schedules and things like that. But I do believe if we're doing it just because it's convenient, I don't believe how in the world can we worship God, truly worship him, if everything we do here is for our convenience. If it doesn't bother our schedule, if it doesn't bother our time and our things, then let's change it so we can be convenient. Can I ask you a question? I'm talking to every one of us, including myself. When's the last time you've been to an altar? People say, well, the altar is for you to go and repent. No, the altar is for you to go and worship too. When's the last time you went to the altar and just thank the Lord? Or pray for a relative or problem or situation? Some people have told me, I don't need the altar, I can take care of it myself. And you're headed for a disaster. Don't tell me it's wrong to live together. I'm going to do it anyway. I've counseled a lot of people before they get married. From their teens to their 80s. And you would be surprised the number of them that tell me, preacher, let me ask you a question. Teens to in their 80s. Now that we're getting married, surely it's all right for us to have sex. Because we're getting married. Oh, so God is going to change his Bible and his word so that you can have a little bit of fun and pleasure before you get to the place where God says you can have that fun and pleasure. If God changes the Bible in any area, the whole Bible's a lie. And they'll ask me that. I'm talking about deacons. I'm talking about pastors' children. I'm talking about people who teach Sunday school. I'm talking about people that everybody thinks living right with God. And yet they'll ask me that question. And that tells me they're already doing it. They want me to stamp my approval on it. I'm not going to stamp my approval on sin. You may not like me. You may not like what I say. But I'm telling you what, I'm not going to change the Word of God. I didn't write that. God wrote that. Don't tell me what to do. Give me a religion that doesn't tell me what to do. America at large has a real authority problem. We have come to be gods ourselves, and we don't want to answer to nobody. We want to say, I am right, you're wrong, and if you force me to do something, I'm still going away knowing I'm in charge. You know what the Bible calls that? Rebellion. Christians have authority problems too, folks. And they hold back God's blessings, and when they won't be led, and when they won't follow, and they always feel like they know better. It's called rebellion. Some have had bad experience with some authority in the past. And what happens? They want to take it out on God. They want to punish God. So they leave God's house, or they go to another church, and they get less involved. And all they do is think and tell everybody about what somebody, some pastor, some authority did to them in the other church. Proverbs 29:1 says, he that being often reproved hardened his neck shall suddenly be destroyed, and that without remedy. You know what often reproved means? He that has been dealt with about a problem and ignores the one, the leader, the authority that's talking to him. Some seem disappointed sometimes with God and with his answers to their prayers. They don't like it when he says no. And they also don't like it when God sends them a pastor. They love the pastor at first. And they take the pastor out sometimes, but really it is God. And they begin then listening. And so a problem comes up. You know what happens? They begin to insult the pastor behind his back. They talk about him behind his back. Listen to me. They really are insulting God. Now that's religion. Praying for what is right and then calling it wrong. Asking for leaders but refuse to follow the leaders. You know, if your leader is wrong, God will take care of him. But he doesn't need you to do it. Give me a religion that has no responsibility. I mean, a popular religion does not include obligations. I don't want responsibility. I mean, I don't want to be tied down. How many times I've asked people, will you be a Sunday school teacher? I don't want to be tied down. You want to do this? I don't want to be tied down. I've got too many things in my life. If you're getting so busy that you can't serve God, you're busier than God ever intended you to be. I don't want to have to do anything. I want to have freedom. I want to have liberty. I want to be in charge of my life and my belongings. I want to be the boss of my life. David said, shall I make a sacrifice of that which does not cost me anything? If Christianity doesn't cost you something, you probably don't have Christianity. We ought to use our talents that God gives us. We're responsible to God to how we use our talents. Maybe you know sign language. Are you using it? Maybe you play an instrument. Are you doing it? Maybe you can sing. Have you stopped? God has blessed you with ability. You may play the guitar. Play it. You may play the drums. Play it. They sang that song this morning about dancing. You know, I'm glad I'm behind the pulpit. Thank you. There is a responsibility in true Christianity, but today giant religion systems are so glad to have people join them. They're perfectly willing to put up with anything about anybody, about anything, and they'll settle for nothing as long as the people come, but it doesn't involve any obligations or responsibilities. Let me tell you something. We are responsible for cleanliness. The Bible says, wash you and make you clean. Put away the evil in your heart and your doing from before mine eyes and cease to do evil. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 1, therefore, beloved, since we have the promise, let us cleanse ourselves from everything that defiles our body and spirit. Bible Christianity involves a clean heart, clean hands, and clean heads. Compassion. We have the responsibility of compassion. God expects us to love people. In fact, 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 8, Peter said finally, be of all of one mind, having compassion one for another. Love the brethren. Do we truly love each other? Do we truly care about someone else? Do we really mean when we say we love them that we love them? Do we really love a lost world? Have we got so used to them that we stopped telling them and trying to reach them for Jesus Christ? There's two men that I've been working on now for about 30 years. 30 years. I see them basically once a week. They're getting closer and closer. In fact, one of them a couple weeks ago almost got right with God. But the very last minute he said, let me wait. I want to tell you something. My heart breaks for them. My heart breaks for every one of you and every one of our church members and church families that go astray or not doing what God wants them to do or not being as faithful as God wants them to be and really as faithful as they really can be if they want to be. You're hurting the church. You're hurting Christ. You're hurting God. You're hurting the testimony of Fairview. Brother, love is how the world knows we're different. In fact, they knew they were children, Christians, by their love. And in conduct, our behavior is to be based on what we believe. Colossians said, but wherefore, whatever ye do, whether in word or deed, do all in the name of Jesus Christ, giving thanks to God through him. Let me ask you a question. Everything you think about, everything you do, everything you say, does it give God glory? Does the friends you run around with, does it give God glory? Are you having friends that build you up in the Lord or pull you down in the world? I talked to a man the other day. His daughter is dating an unsaved person. Here's what he told me. He said, well, you know, he's a good man, good fella. And I know he'll take care of her. And I said to him, he's not right with God. And he marries your daughter. Most likely your daughter will get out of church and get away from God. They'll pull her down. Parents, you better listen to me. I know it's hard. Be careful who your children date. Well, I have no influence. You better have some influence. And I know that some people can say they're right with God, they're not right with God, and fool us. But if you know they're not, work on them. Lead them to the Lord. We point out that the person who accepts the basic steps of responsibility to be clean, to be compassionate, to be have right conduct, literally finds the truth in 1 John 5:3 to be their lifestyle. His commandments are not grievous to us. Other than what I'm saying, if you're a child of God, the Word of God doesn't bother you to do it. True Christians rejoice in being able to serve and to sacrifice and to surrender their rights to God. The most popular religions in the world are just that, religions of the world, not religions of the Bible or religion of God. And there is a great need to preach the true gospel of the good news, that Jesus Christ came and came in incarnate. He was a God who became a baby in a manger, matriculated on planet Earth for 33 and a half years, lived and preached and talk to people and love people and save people and heal people and raise people from the dead. And they crucified him and they put him in a grave. But on the third day, he came forth. And next thing you know, and 50 days later, he ascended up into heaven. And the angel said, he met a Galilee, why stand he gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus, so come like he is. Right now, we're in the church age. We're waiting for the rapture of the church. We're waiting for Jesus Christ to say, hit it, or God say to Jesus, shout, go. And the trumpet sounds and the shout, and the archangel breaks forth. Jesus steps forth from the throne and steps out on the cloud. And everyone that's been born again, that's died, are in the grave. Their bodies are going to come out of the grave. Those who have been annihilated through wars and their bodies are unrecognizable, their bodies are going to come back together. And all of those who've died in Christ are going to rise out of their grave and meet the Lord in the air. Then we which are alive, who are children of God, will take out of this world and will be with Jesus and our loved ones forevermore. You can't be ready for the rapture if you're not ready in your life with God. What is your relationship with God this morning? Do you truly know him as a personal Savior? Is he the boss of your life? Are you truly following him? Are you truly faithful to him? Is he first place in your life? Or have you grown backwards and cold and indifferent? Have we got to the point that we just go through the emotions and we have forgot that Christianity is more than emotions? It's a relationship. It's worship. It's adoring him. Heads are bowed and eyes are closed. I don't know where you are this morning. I don't know where you are in your relationship with Jesus Christ. But I love you, and the most important thing I can tell you is don't leave this building if you don't truly have a relationship with Jesus Christ. He loves you. He died for you. He ever watches over everything you're doing. And if you're alive today, it's by the grace of God. If you're breathing, it's because of the grace of God. You have health, it's because of the grace of God. Most important thing, he loved you so much that while we were yet sinners in our worst state, he died for us to save us, to take us out of the hell itself, so to speak, and bring us to the pathway to heaven. I hope you have that. If you're here this morning, heads are bowed and no one looking around, you'll say, Pastor, I look at my heart this morning. Something is missing. I'm not where I used to be. I'm not sure if I'm saved. I'm not sure if heaven is my home. There's so many things in my life that ought not to be there. I know it, and I know God knows it. And I'm not going to embarrass you in any way, but you'll let me pray for you. I don't call your name or anything, but I will be praying for you. You'll just acknowledge the fact that you are in need of prayer. In your relationship with God, would you slip up your hand quickly and right back down? God bless you. Are there others all across this building? Preacher, pastor, pray for me. Father, this morning we can come to church and we hear messages, and some of those messages touch us. We know they touch us because we want to argue. And yet we will know that there's things in our lives wrong, and we'll leave here with it. God, help us to be real with you and real with ourselves. These that raised their hand this morning, you know their situation. I pray, Lord, that they'll cry out to you before it's everlastingly too late. And Lord, I pray that you'll get a hold of one of us, someone, and talk to them about their relationship with God. And even right where they're sat here this morning, may they simply pray, Dear Jesus, forgive me of my sins. Lord, I've not been following you, or I didn't know you. Forgive me. Come into my heart, or cleanse my heart. Restore the joy of my salvation. Help me live for you. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you.